the headlines, CWI launches Coach Foundation courses, Warner recovering from COVID, an ex-World Athletics chief found guilty and jailed. Good evening and welcome to the Major ZDK Sports Edition, Wednesday, September 16, 2020. I am your presenter, Terry Laraji. Now for the details. We begin tonight balling off with cricket. Cricket West Indies CWI has this week launched its first virtual Coach Foundation courses as part of the long-term Skerrett Shallow administration's Cricket First strategic plan in building coaching skills around the region through the new coach and player development pathway. Four consecutive foundation coaching courses, updated and modernized to align with CWI's development pathway, are taking place virtually for over 70 contracted players across the region from September 14 to 17. Players such as West Indies white ball captain Kyron Pollard, Antigua's own Rakeem Cornwall, Shane Dowridge and Roston Chase will be taking their first coaching steps, developing their understanding of technical and tactical coaching, whilst also learning about nutrition, mental well-being and physical development. These players participating in this foundation level will get the opportunity to test their coaching prowess and receive the coaching skills and confidence to increase their impact with planned community cricket activities such as kiddie cricket and club and schools programs. While speaking on the Sportsline show, Dominic Warne, CWI's commercial director, explained that CWI have been able to roll out these programs thanks in a big way to the partnership extended this week with one of their major sponsors, Betway.
The revenue that drives into Cricket West Indies, it's fantastic for us because it means that we can continue with the investment into cricket, particularly youth cricket and the emerging player side of cricket and coaching as well. It's very valuable revenue.
Warne said that CWI is putting further development into the future of West Indies cricket with its revamping of kiddie cricket and up to under-23 level.
Some good news going on both in terms of on an island-by-island basis and around the region as well. So the fact that we have the under-19 men's and the under-19s ladies and all the age group down to under-15s as well, and the whole Future Stars program, which is what we're calling it essentially from what is the kiddie cricket program in terms of primary school level up to the Future Stars level, which is secondary school, and then the Rising Stars, which is those players breaking through from sort of under-15 level through to pushing to bring to the top level teams. It's a major investment for us, and that's where the future of West Indies cricket and the success of West Indies cricket will come from.
Dominic Warne. This also gives CWI the opportunity to identify those players showing an affinity for coaching, which can deliver a potential career beyond playing. Meanwhile, Trinidad and Tobago Prime Minister Dr. Keith Rowley says the recent hosting of the Hero Caribbean Premier League CPL T20 tournament was a template that can be followed, but people must be disciplined and listen to advice which would allow events and businesses to run smoothly. It's the best positivity we've had, and all our guests who came and who proved us correct that we could have in a pandemic create the health environment which is loosely called a bubble so that the business of international professional cricket could have taken place. I thank you all, Rowley commented while speaking at a COVID-19 media conference. Speaking recently on ZDK's Sportsline show, Marketing Director Dominic Warne suggested that the time squads get to spend together during quarantine can also benefit a team.
I think what they've done with the franchise is that certainly for TKR, they kept a lot of consistency with their players. It creates a familiarity even when players are only together for 3 or 4 weeks of the year. But also that works well from a training perspective as well. And I think just as we were saying about the England Test series, one of the unintended benefits of the COVID situation has been that we've had players together in an elite training environment for a long period of time. And that will really help. And you've seen that with TKR combining both that consistent approach, but also some fantastic exponents of T20 cricket and using that environment to the best of their advantage.
Warne also noted that the CPL is a great opportunity to showcase local talent, a situation which is constantly under review.
Some good news going on both in terms of on an island-by-island basis and around the region as well. So the fact that we have the under-19 men's and the under-19s ladies and all the age group down to under-15s as well, and the whole Future Stars program, which is what we're calling it essentially from what is the kiddie cricket program in terms of primary school level up to the Future Stars level, which is secondary school, and then the Rising Stars, which is those players breaking through from sort of under-15 level through to pushing to bring to the the top level teams. It's a major investment for us, and that's where the future of West Indies cricket and the success of West Indies cricket will come from.
Dominic Warn. This season, the entire CPL was held in Trinidad from August 18 to September 10, with matches played at the Brian Lara Cricket Academy in Taruba and at the Queen's Park Oval in Port of Spain. Despite criticism from many quarters for the lack of a high standard of play, CPL proved that events can be held during the pandemic once steps are put in place to make it safe. Trinbago Knight Riders won their fourth CPL title with an 8-wicket win over the St. Lucia Zooks in the final. Meantime, former Jamaica cricketers Nehemiah Perry and Wayne Lewis say that the Jamaica Talawas will have a hard task convincing all-rounder Andre Russell to stay with the franchise for the CPL next season. Although the Talawas managed to make the final four of the competition this year after finishing bottom of the table last season, they only managed to register 3 wins from 11 games in the campaign. Citing irreconcilable differences with management, Russell said in April that 2020 would be his last season with the team when his contract expires. This announcement was after former teammate Chris Gayle's public spat with the team after his services were not retained despite 2 years remaining on his contract. Perry says that while Russell would like to continue playing CPL cricket in Jamaica, he is not confident that the Talawas can offer the unifying atmosphere necessary for him to change his mind about leaving. And England women have named a 16-player squad for their T20 international series against the West Indies, which begins on Monday. Bada Georgia Alwis is the only player missing from the squad that reached the T20 World Cup semi-finals in Australia in March. Alwis is absent due to a back injury, with all-rounder Sophia Dunkley and fast bowler Katie George included. Windies opening batsman Hayley Matthews is looking forward to the challenge England will pose.
I think they're a very good side. They've obviously shown that over the last couple of years. But I think coming down here, we get to live at the ground and train at the ground. So I think we're kind of looking at it as our home ground after a little bit. Yeah, I think it's really going to be a case of just playing good cricket overall. We're definitely going to have to look at their squad, you know, see what kind of players they're looking to come at us with and, you know, be able to plan and, I guess, go out there and execute good skills against them. And I mean, it's always going to be a tough series when we play England at home, but I think we have the talent and the skill in the dressing room, and like I said, everyone's hungry. I'm really wanting to get out there and prove everyone wrong about, I guess, how we did at the World Cup in March.
Hayley Matthews. Meanwhile, crowds will return to international cricket in Australia for the first time since March later this month, with confirmation that a limited number of spectators will be able to attend the Australia-New Zealand women's matches being staged at Allan Border Field in Brisbane, although those watching are encouraged to keep their cheering to a minimum. The availability of tickets was announced by Cricket Australia on Monday for the T20 International and One Day International Series, which begins on September 26. Capacity at the venue will be capped at 50% under Queensland Government COVID-19 regulations, which includes everyone in the ground, while there are various other protocols and restrictions in place. One of the specific recommendations Cricket Australia has put out involves shouting and cheering to cut the risk of droplet spread. Meantime, a 212-run partnership for the 6-wicket between Carey and Maxwell, who both scored hundreds, was just enough to pull Australia to a 3-wicket thrilling victory and a 2-1 series win today in the final one-day international against England. Needing 10 runs off the last over, Starkeet Rashid's first ball for 6 as the Aussies got home with just 2 balls to spare. Scores Australia 305 for 7 off 49.4 overs, Maxwell 108, Carey 106, Stark 11 not out off 3 deliveries, Wokes 2 for 46, England 302 for 7, Bairstow 112, Billings 57, Wokes 53 not out, Zampa 3 for 51, Stark 3 for 74. An ex-Pakistan seamer, Rana Navid Al-Hassan, has become the second player to allege racism at Yorkshire, saying systematic taunting occurred at the club. Navid's allegations came after former Yorkshire spinner Azim Rafiq said institutional racism at the club left him close to taking his own life. A Yorkshire statement said Navid's comments were very concerning. In other sporting developments tonight, kicking into football, title sponsor of the Greys Green Community Football League, Anderson Carty, told of how he is also contributing towards helping local teams get ready for competitive football in case the Antigua and Barbuda Football Association ABFA competitions restart. Speaking on the Sportsline show, Carty said he has donated to the Hoppers Club to help with its development.
Oh, very well. And as I said, in respect, I can speak to the Hoppers Football Club in particular. Quite recently, last week, and I believe it is, the team got together and they did a cleanup of the grounds. They've started the work there. Of course, I made a contribution at their request, and I will also always seek to do so in the interest of developing my community.
Carty noted the excitement shown by the young players to get back into playing.
The youngsters are excited to get back into the football league. You will see on a Saturday and sometimes on a Sunday at the King George grounds as well. There are activities taking place where they are knocking the ball around and doing some physical exercises in preparation for a clean start when and hopefully if the ABFA is able to get the program going in earnest in the usual October month.
Anderson Carty. The ABFA is due to make a decision shortly on whether or not the 2019-20 season can restart, which was halted in March due to the coronavirus pandemic, or for the new season to begin. Meantime, former CONCACAF president Jack Warner has left the hospital and is now in quarantine as he continues to recover from infection with the coronavirus. The 77-year-old former football official turned politician confirmed in a statement that he had been released from the Couva Hospital in Trinidad on Sunday. Warner was rushed to the hospital 2 weeks ago after testing positive for the disease and experiencing some of the symptoms. Warner, who had a tough time battling the disease, reflected that he would not have inflicted it on his worst enemy. And Bournemouth beat Crystal Palace 11-10 in an amazing Carabao Cup shootout after a goalless draw to set up a third-round tie with Manchester City yesterday. The excellent finishing in the shootout was nowhere to be seen in 90 minutes as Bournemouth dominated with 17 shots to Crystal Palace's 4, but only 3 were on target. Shooting into basketball and NBA matches played last night in the Eastern Conference Finals. The Heat were too hot for the Celtics, winning 117-114 in overtime to take a 1-0 series lead. While in the Western Conference semifinals, the Nuggets clipped the Clippers in the deciding seventh game, 104-89, as Murray shot 40 points to take the series 4-3. Serving into tennis, Novak Djokovic showed little sign of being affected by his US Open default as he bounced back to beat Salvatore Caruso at the Italian Open. Top seed Djokovic had not played since he was disqualified at Flushing Meadow earlier this month after hitting a line judge with the ball in the fourth round. But he returned to action in typically composed fashion in Italy, dispatching world number 87 Caruso 6-3, 6-2. Pedaling into cycling, Miguel Lopez won stage 17 today of the Tour de France. Primoz Roglic extended his lead in the race. Lopez pulled clear of the other general classification contenders on the final climb of the day, beating Roglic into second by 15 seconds. The stage victory took Lopez into third overall, while Roglic moved almost a minute clear as his fellow Slovenian Tadej Pogačar came home third. Swinging into golf now, Tiger Woods ranks Winged Foot as one of the three hardest courses in the world as he prepares for this week's US Open. The championship is making a fifth visit to the New York course, only once has the winning score been under par. It's up there next to Oakmont and Carnoustie as far as sheer difficulty without doing anything to it, said Woods, a three-time US Open champion. Woods missed his first cut in a major as a professional when Winged Foot last staged the US Open in 2006. Tiger says he can identify with the struggles of Serena Williams and Rafael Nadal as they each bid to make history in their sport, with time working against them. This week, 40-year-old Woods will yet again seek to add to his major haul of 15 in pursuit of Jack Nicklaus's record tally of 18. It was a mark that Woods appeared destined to surpass when he reached 14 in 2008. His 2019 Masters triumph ended an 11-year drought brought on by injury and personal issues. Fellow American Williams has similarly hit a barrier in her quest to catch Margaret Court's Grand Slam total of 24, with the 38-year-old having been one behind since 2017. Nadal, the youngest of the trio at 34, and also one shy of the all-time mark, faces a slightly different challenge in that his target could be a moving one, with Roger Federer still looking to increase his number of slam victories above 20. The first round of the US Open tees off tomorrow with Woods paired up with Colin Morikawa, who won last month's USPGA Championship. Running into athletics, Lamine Dayak, the ex-head of athletics governing body, has been jailed after being found guilty of corruption. The 87-year-old Singhalese faced corruption and money laundering charges linked to the Russian doping scandal. Dayak was convicted of accepting bribes from athletes suspected of doping to cover up test results and letting them continue competing, including in the 2012 London Olympics. He was sentenced to 4 years in prison, two of them suspended. Dayak's lawyers said he would be appealing against the judgment, which they called unfair and inhumane. Meantime, reigning Olympic sprint double champion Elaine Thompson-Herah insists a recent battle with injury and past major games disappointments has only served to strengthen her resolve and determination. The 28-year-old runner was the toast of the Rio Olympics in 2016 after smashing the competition by speeding to blazing winds in the 100 and 200 meter sprints. It seemed the Jamaican was only destined for major success from there on in, but things have not quite unfolded in that manner as Thompson-Herah finished a disappointing fifth at the World Championships with serious Achilles injuries plaguing her explosive nature. Now injury-free, the Jamaican sprint queen is all the more determined to make up for lost time as she looks towards the Olympic season ahead with extra motivation in defending her crowns. And finally tonight on this day in history, in 1988, restored to the captaincy, Javed Miandad proved yet again what a master batsman he was by hitting 211 against Australia in Karachi. After putting on 196 with Shoaib Mohammed, who made 94, he declared at 469 for 9. Australia, dismissed for 165 and 116, lost by an innings 188 runs. It was the fifth of Javed's six test double centuries. And that story has brought us to the end of our sporting developments for tonight. Now to recap our top story. Cricket West Indies has this week launched its first virtual coach foundation courses as part of the long-term Skerrett Shallow Administration's Cricket First strategic plan in building coaching skills around the region through the new coach and player development pathway. I've been your presenter, Terry Laraji. Thank you for listening. To watch ZDK Sports Package, go to the YouTube channel, Terry Laraji, The Straight Bat, and subscribe. Stay tuned now for your Voice of America update. Do enjoy the rest of your evening. Rally round the West Indies. One forever.